Greetings from Jackson Pal Pharmaceuticals Limited. Today, I, Dr. Vipin Tyagi, welcome you to the lecture series on women's intimate health by Dr. Ragini Agarwal and Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology. This is the second of the series and is in association with AOGD. Today's topic of discussion is urinary incontinence. We feel privileged to welcome our entire distinguished faculty, our chief guest, Dr. Jignesh Shah from Ahmedabad. He is the president of Indian Menopause Society. Our moderators for the case-based panel discussion are Dr. Ragini Agarwal, Vice President Foxy, Founder President Harok Gaini, and Clinical Director W. Pratiksha Hospital. And we have Dr. Chandan Kachru, Chairperson, Udan Project, Harok Gaini, and Consultant, W. Pratiksha Hospital, Gurugram. In the panel, we have from Delhi, Dr. Ashila Batra, Dr. Mala Srivastav, Dr. Ranjana Sharma from Gurugram, Dr. Raman Tavar from Bhayandar, Dr. Rajendra Nagarkatti, and from Vijaypur, Dr. Vidya Tobi. We welcome all attendees present with us today. Hope all of you enjoy this knowledge sharing session, this unique webinar. This unique webinar also has in the audience doctors and along with them the women they care for from the society. During the session, we request the attendees, please post your queries by text in the chat box, which will be answered at the end of the session. Due to the time constraint, please share your questions during the webinar itself as text. Kindly note this session will be streaming on Facebook Live, and the recording will remain on our YouTube channel for reference and knowledge sharing. I will now request Dr. Ragini Agarwal ma'am to kindly initiate the session. Ma'am.
Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
Hello? Yeah.
Yes.
Very good evening to all of you. Welcome on this series of Women Intimate Health. Thank you, Dr. Vipin and Jackson Pal, for giving a unconditional support for knowledge sharing. And I'm thankful to Dr. Jignesh Shah, who has spared his valuable time to be here. He's from his very busy schedule. He's the President, Indian Menopause Society. And thank you, sir, making me the national founder chairperson for Aesthetic Health of Indian Menopause Society. This series, I have my many friends who are working in the field of urogyne, Dr. Ranjana Sharma, Dr. Mala Srivastav. Then I have Raman, who is a urologist, and Dr. Vidya Tobi from South, Dr. Nagarkatti from Mumbai. And together we are going to give you an insight, a very, very common problem of urinary incontinence, means leaking, from which women suffer very, very silently and never talk about it. And not only this, I have with me Professor Ashila Batra, my very dear friend from Safdarjung, and she is the president of Narchi Delhi also. And I welcome again Dr. Jignesh Shah. Please say a few words about this, our seminar.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ragini, for today's invite. Thank you, Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology and AOGD for organizing this webinar on very important subject. Friends, as a president of Indian Menopause Society, let me take this opportunity to introduce Indian Menopause Society to all of you. Indian Menopause Society is a multidisciplinary society which was established in 1995, and this year 2020 we are celebrating Silver Jubilee year. All our past presidents had worked very hard for spreading awareness about menopausal health related problems amongst gynecologists, amongst paramedical person, as well as to the public. Now in India, average lifespan of Indian women has increased to more than 70 years, so as to women has to spend more than one third of her life into menopausal years. You would not believe that at present in India, more than 20 crore of women are living in 40 plus age group, and many of them are having distressing menopausal symptoms which need immediate attention. So it is very important, friends, to keep ourselves updated regarding management of menopausal problems and to provide our women quality of life. This year's theme is Flying High with the Wings of Menopause, and motto of the year is Preventing the Preventable. Friends, we had planned number of activities, but because of this lockdown condition, our activities are at halt, but we are continuing with the webinar and quiz activities. Now, regarding today's webinar, it is organized by Dr. Ragini and this Indian Academy of Cosmetic Dermatology and Gynecology and AOGD. And the topic is Intimate Health Lecture Series, where today's panel discussion will be on urinary incontinence. Don't be shy about the leak. Urinary incontinence, again, it is not uncommon in our population, and it has many physical as well as psychological effects which affects quality of life of women. So it is very important for women to come out with this problem, and it is very important for gynecologists as well as urologists as well as all the healthcare providers to understand about this problem and to bring relief to the patient. I offer my best wishes to today's webinar. Thank you. Namaskar.
Ma'am, you need to unmute.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for being with us here. And अब हम सीधे अपना वेबिनार शुरू करते हैं इस इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक पर. हमारे साथ हमारी बहुत सारी महिलाओं ने भी ज्वाइन कर रखा है, तो हम लोग अपने प्रोग्राम को इस ढंग से बोलेंगे. नेचुरली बेस हमारा इंग्लिश होगा, लेकिन बीच बीच में हम लोग हिंदी में भी उसको एक्सप्लेन करते रहेंगे. एंड लैंग्वेज को वी विल ट्राइंग टू बी वेरी सिंपल. एंड फॉर डॉक्टर्स ऑल्सो, वॉट इज अवर एम? टू टेल यू हाउ टू काउंसल योर patient when they come with the problems. And this whole thing which we have made basically on the basis of an advanced patient education platform, because when the patient come to our OPD, and that time when they want all the knowledge, it is very difficult for any doctors to share at that time each and everything. So with this type of program, we are reaching to the masses in the society, and by joining this program, they can understand the basic problems, which many time they don't understand that the treatment is available. And when they go to the doctor, they are not understand the each and every treatment which is offered to them. So I think my very, very esteemed and panelist, they will tell you everything in very much in detail, and you all are benefited by that. So welcome, I again welcome you all, and start panel. We all know that leaking of the urine without uncontrolled and not voluntary leaking is a very, very distressing point for women. And कितनी बार ऐसा होता है कि खास करके our elderly females, they don't go out of the house because they are very afraid of this thing, whether they will get a toilet or not, and their clothes will soil. So if you see the data, this is not something which is affecting a very small population. There is a urinary incontinence which affect 200 million population worldwide. Or 4 in 1, yani 25% women, even younger women over 18, because of some or other reason, they experience episode of leaking urine. And over 60, it increased almost 25% women, they have varying variety degree of the leakage. And it will go on, initially nahi hota hai, chalo bataye na bataye karke, they have at least 7-8 years of their life, they are leaking, and a very small portion even then go to a doctor for this thing. So if so many women are dealing with incontinence, why have you never heard women talk about it? This is something which is not discussed. Yes, most of the women problem was not discussed now, but gradually things are coming out. And after so many years, we are talking about the sanitary pad openly in a society, which is nobody used to talk about menstruation, then menopause, then sanitary pad and menstrual hygiene. It was an eye-opener even. So many women feel embarrassed, think it is just a normal part of aging, or believe they can cope with it on their own. So whatever the reason, it is just not something most women talk about with their friends, family or physician. So in this platform, we are talking about this to doctors and to the women from the society. Might be they themselves or their friends or their sisters, their mother, they are suffering silently with this problem. I'm just sharing few live problems which is shared by my own patients in my clinic. I love to exercise and my favorite is running. But after a pregnancy, if I have a water and go for the running, I leak. So I run in the rain, as that was the only way to hide my bladder leakage. I'm heading marketing department in an MNC. I stopped wearing pantsuit, and I don't know when I leak while speaking and sneezing. And that is a very, very big point. Today's woman at the 40, 42, she's on the having a highest post, taking a seminar, and suddenly there's a blob on their pantsuit. After menopause, it is gradually being very difficult to hold urine for me. Now I'm hesitating to go anywhere if I think I will not get toilet easily. And more embarrassing, I'm afraid to have sex because sometimes I leak during intercourse. One elderly lady, she has complained, now I avoid to go to satsang due to this leaking because I am not... I don't know whether I'll be able to reach to the toilet or not. So this is a food for thought. A 59-year-old grand multiparous woman has a last menses at 52, presented complaining of difficult biting, urgency, frequency, nocturia, has episode of urge incontinence 2 times per year, and she attributes infrequency of these episodes to coping strategies. So gradually these things are increasing, and once urine trickles and cuts off before she feels that her bladder is empty. Recently episode happened in a public gathering. Now think of the embarrassment and the effect on that woman. So bladder leakage or urine leakage is common. If you struggle with bladder leakage, you are not alone, think first thing. And secondly, the treatment is available for that. Don't be shy, but ask your doctor why it is happening to me. So I welcome again my experts, Dr. Ranna Sharma, Professor Archila Batra, Dr. Mala Srivastava, Dr. Najinder Nagarkatti, Dr. Vidya Thobi, and Dr. Raman Tawar. They are heading different medical association in their own capacity. So let's talk about it. the bladder control problems, leaking, urinary incontinence, whatever name you want to give, take control of your bladder and your life. So, Dr. Mala, the first, you are our opening batsman. Dr. Mala is the president of the AOGD, and she is at the prestigious institute, Gangaram Hospital. Kindly please define what is urinary incontinence, what are the causes, why it is happening, what type of the urinary incontinence is there. Over to Mala.
Thanks, Dr. Raghini, for inviting me to this panel discussion. Urinary incontinence is defined as an involuntary leakage of urine. It's a common problem, but of course, 80% of these common problems can be treated. It can be frequent or occasional, a few dribbles or total loss of control. It can be triggered by certain activities or the result of certain risk factors. Most important that we have to tell our patients that it is a treatable condition, and definitely doctors can help you with this problem. Now, you want to know what is the risk factors for incontinence? It is the childbirth injuries that is one of the most important cause of urinary incontinence. Vaginal birth due to injury to pelvic muscles and connective tissue, there is a damage of pudendal nerve. Instrumental delivery, delivery of a macrosomic baby or prolonged labor, obesity, menopause. When a patient attains menopause, there is hypoestrogenemia, which is causing urethral mucosal atrophy and bladder irritation. Again, it can lead to either urge or stress incontinence. Sometimes it's the family history, which is important. Cognitive impairment, smoking, connective tissue disorder, all these can lead to urinary incontinence. Before we come to the urinary incontinence, we have to understand how we maintain continence. How we maintain continence of urine? A little bit of scientific, because there is anatomical support, there's support of the neck of the bladder and urethra, they're supported by the pubourethral ligament and arcus tendinus, vagina and support, and most important, levator and anni muscles. In normal continent women, there's increase of the abdominal pressure, which is transmitted equally to the bladder, base of the bladder and neck. When these supports are lost, there's a hypermobility of urethra and the urethra is never in position. So there is a loss of pressure transmission to the urethra. Urethra, bladder, neck are unable to close. As a result, there is a reduced urethral closing pressure, which in turn makes the loss of continence. Then again, there is a sphincter support, which is important.
Say leakage ho jata hai, agar uske upar pressure padta hai. What is happening here? The same thing. Your bladder is supported by a hammock-like structure, which become loose, or iska jo internal mechanism hota hai, wo defective ho jata hai, aur wo urine ko support nahi kar pata hai. थोड़ा सा भी खींचते छाकते या आपके दिमाग में भी लगता है कि आपको जाना है या उसकी इनर्वेशन खराब होती है तो लीकेज के लिए भागना पड़ता है. लिविंग विद दिस यूरिन इनकॉन्टिनेंस कैन बी वेरी वेरी चैलेंजिंग बिकॉज इट कैन इंटरफेयर विद योर डे टू डे एक्टिविटी, सोशल लाइफ, और जस्ट प्लेन इनकन्वीनियंट एंड एम्बेरसिंग. योर क्लोथ बिकम सॉयल, यूर ऑलवेज हैव अ स्मेल. सो now I invite Dr. Anna Sharma. She is a trained urogynecologist from England. Madam is a very vast experience in urogyne, which is a new upcoming branch of gynecology. How to evaluate a case of urinary incontinence, special focus on voiding diary. Whenever a patient of this comes, the first thing which we say is the voiding diary. So please understand what is voiding diary. Even as a doctor, what we are going to, how to counsel our patient, that is very, very important. Over to madam. Dr. Renna, please unmute yourself.
So thank you very much, Ragini, for including me in the panel. And I'm really fortunate that I'm speaking not only to doctors, but also to some women out there who are suffering or who would like to have some knowledge about the subject. So it's very good. So once we, agar hum unhe batayenge, to wo aage jaake apni family mein, apne friends ko bhi isse ka fayda de sakti hain. So when it comes to the goal of evaluation, हम करना क्या चाहते हैं, हम क्या पता लगाना चाहते हैं जब वो हमारी OPD में आके बैठे. तो एक तो we want to take a good history, उनसे उनकी सारी समस्या का डिटेल नॉलेज हमें हो, जिससे कि वी कैन फाइंड कोई डायग्नोसिस हम अपने मन में बना सकें कि जो डॉक्टर माला ने अभी बात बताई कि इज इट द प्रॉब्लम इज इन द ब्लैडर, कि ब्लैडर शुड ओनली कॉन्ट्रैक्ट व्हेन यू आर सिटिंग इन द टॉयलेट ऑन द टॉयलेट सीट, व्हेन यू आर रेडी टू पी, यू आर रेडी टू पास यूरिन, देन इट शुड कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. बट समटाइम्स व्हाट हैपेंस, आप अपने आराम से घूम रहे बाजार में एंड सडनली आपके ब्लैडर ने कॉन्ट्रैक्ट किया और आपको भागने का लग रहा है, जाना पड़ेगा. ये नहीं होना चाहिए. कभी कभी ब्लैडर बिल्कुल ठीक है, जैसा डॉक्टर रागिनी ने अभी फिर से बताया कि उसका नेक में प्रॉब्लम है और नेक वीक है और इसकी वजह से वो आराम से निकल जाती है खांसने से, छींकने से. सो बाय टेकिंग योर हिस्ट्री आई वुड लाइक टू हैव अ प्रिजम्प्टिव डायग्नोसिस, जिसके बेसिस पे, ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस वी कैन गो टू द प्रीवियस Can we have the previous slide, please? Can we have the previous slide? Yeah. So then we also, I also want to know how bothersome it is. Can I have the next slide, please? So I also want to know how bothersome your problem is. कि किसी को यूरिन निकल तो जाती है पर हम जब उनसे कहते हैं कि आपको कोई ट्रीटमेंट की जरूरत है, नहीं वो मुझे परेशानी नहीं करता, महीने में एक आध बार कभी हो गया, मुझे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता, परफेक्टली फाइन. सो आई नीड टू नो व्हाट इज द लेवल ऑफ बॉदर एंड वेदर द वुमन हु हैज कम टू माय ओपीडी हैज मेंशन दिस इज इंटरेस्टेड इन टेकिंग सम ट्रीटमेंट. देन आई हैव टू प्लान सम ट्रीटमेंट विदाउट डूइंग too many investigations and too many interventions, jisse ki hum usko fayda de sake, and considering the risk and benefit of no treatment. Agar treatment dene ki zarurat nahi hai to we would not like to give you the treatment. And then agar ye hame ek kisi aur badi samasya ki taraf point kar raha hai, then I will also ask you to go for some more complex testing or special referrals to different departments. So can I have the last slide? Yeah. So how do we evaluate? Kya karte hain? When a patient comes to the OPD, I want to take a good history. And after taking a good history, I would like to examine the patient. I would ask her to lie down on the table and then do an abdominal examination. I will also do a vaginal examination. And after that, I will get a lot of information and I will reach some sort of diagnosis. Mujhe man mein lag raha hai ki usko ye hai. उसके बाद आई विल आस्क सम प्रिलिमिनरी इन्वेस्टिगेशन, जैसे एक यूरिन का टेस्ट करना बहुत ज़रूरी है क्योंकि जो भी यूरिन के सिम्टम्स होते हैं वो यूरिन इन्फेक्शन में भी वही सब सिम्टम्स होते हैं, और कितना ईजिली हम अगर यूरिनरी इन्फेक्शन पता लगा लें तो हम उसको ट्रीट कर दें, हमें आगे कुछ करने की ज़रूरत है. फिर पोस्ट वॉइस रेजिडुअल वॉल्यूम, आफ्टर समबडी हैज़ पास्ड यूरिन, उनको अर्ज हुआ, उन्होंने पास कर दिया, उसके बाद हमें देखना बहुत ज़रूरी है हाउ मच यूरिन इज लेफ्ट इन द ब्लैडर. अगर ज़्यादा यूरिन बच जाती है तो ये अच्छा साइन नहीं है, तो ये हमें पता लगाना बहुत ज़रूरी है. इसका मतलब है कोई ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन हो सकता है जिससे आपकी यूरिन पूरी नहीं निकल रही. एंड देन वी हैव टू गिव देम अ वॉइडिंग डायरी विच आई एम गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन लेटर, एंड देन ऑल्सो गिव देम अ पैड टेस्ट के देखे, ज़रा घूम फिर के आओ, देखें पैड पर यूरिन जमा होती है कि नहीं. Then I will also like to give a quality of life questionnaire, because how much life is affected by these urinary leakages. Okay, and then in some situations I would like to subject them to advanced testing like urodynamics when it's done in a special clinic and done by a technician or a doctor, and then we have a ECG like tracing on a paper, and then we can interpret it and find out what the problem is exactly. And then we also ask them to sit on a special commode and see how they pass urine, and that also gives us a graph and gives us a lot of information. Then some people need special x-rays, and some people also need to go to the operation theater, and then we want to look inside the bladder to see if there is any other problem. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah, so by symptoms, what I want to know, I want to know the problem is in the bladder, as I was telling you before, or at the bladder neck. दोनों का ट्रीटमेंट बिल्कुल फर्क होता है। तो हमें सबसे पहले ये पता लगाना बहुत ज़रूरी है कि हम कौन सी प्रॉब्लम से डील कर रहे हैं, या दोनों थोड़ा थोड़ा दोनों है उसमें, मिक्स्ड इनकॉन्टिनेंस, जिसके बारे में पहले आपको अभी बताया गया। तो अब ब्लैडर में प्रॉब्लम कौन सी समस्याएं जो आप हमें सिम्टम्स बताएंगे जिससे हमें लगेगा कि आपको ब्लैडर में प्रॉब्लम है। आपसे यूरिन रोकी नहीं जाती, जैसे आप अच्छा टीवी सीरियल देख रहे हैं, अपना कुछ काम कर रहे हैं, आपको एकदम से लगा आपको यूरिन पास करने जाना है, तो आपको जाना ही पड़ेगा। आप उसको ये नहीं कर सकते कि अभी थोड़ी देर में जाएंगे तो लीकेज हो जाएगा। और दिन में आप बहुत बार जाते हैं, तो नॉर्मल जाना क्या होता है, करीब 7-8 बार अगर कोई नॉर्मली यूरिन पास करता है दिन में तो वो बिल्कुल नॉर्मल है। 1-2 बार अगर रात में एक बार उठना है तो कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, पर कोई लोग बहुत बार रात में उठते हैं, दिन में बार बार जाते हैं और उनसे रोका नहीं जाता, दे रश टू द टॉयलेट, जब तक टॉयलेट पहुंचे कोई और अगर है तो वहीं पे निकल जाती है। तो इस सब से हमें लगता है कि ब्लैडर में प्रॉब्लम है। पर जब कोई कहे कि हमें खाली खांसने से, छींकने से या दौड़ने से, जॉगिंग करने से निकलता है, तो इसका मतलब है ब्लैडर नेक में प्रॉब्लम है। पर कई बार दोनों थोड़ी थोड़ी प्रॉब्लम्स होती हैं, तो हमें ये भी पता लगाना होता है कि कौन सी प्रॉब्लम ज़्यादा बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है इनके केस में। हर केस में हमें इन्फेक्शन एक्सक्लूड करना है, हमें ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन एक्सक्लूड करना है और हमें प्रेगनेंसी भी एक्सक्लूड करना है, बिकॉज इन प्रेगनेंसी ऑल्सो ऑल दीज सिम्टम्स कैन अकर। एंड यूरिन इन्फेक्शन बहुत कॉमन होता है और सारे जो सिम्टम्स मैंने बोले वो सब यूरिन इन्फेक्शन में हो सकते हैं। कैसे हम पता लगाएं कि ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन तो नहीं है, क्योंकि आप यूरिन पास करने जाते हैं, एकदम से काफ़ी अच्छे से यूरिन निकलती है, खूब ज़ोर से धार आती है, एंड देन यू फिनिश इन अ फ्यू सेकेंड्स एंड यू आर डन विद इट। बट समटाइम्स वॉट हैपन्स, यू सिट देयर एंड यू टेक टाइम टू स्टार्ट पासिंग यूरिन, तो थोड़ा टाइम लगा, ये हेजिटेंसी हुई, फिर थोड़ी 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 निकल रही है, पतली धार है, स्लो स्ट्रीम है, इंटरमिटेंट है, बार बार आपको पेट में जोर लगाते हैं, थोड़ी और यूरिन निकल जाती है। ये सब हमें पॉइंट किस तरफ करते, ये ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन से। ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन में हमें ज़रूर बहुत सीरियस हो सकता है, क्योंकि अगर नीचे ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन है तो यूरिन ऊपर को जाना चाहेगी और यूरिन किडनीज को इन्फेक्शन करके किडनीज को डैमेज कर सकते हैं। ठीक है, तो हमें यूरिन हिस्ट्री हमें क्या लेना है, ये कि कब कैसे शुरू हुई आपको प्रॉब्लम, क्या कोई सर्जरी हुई थी, डिलीवरी हुई थी, या कोई आपने मेडिकेशन लिया, या कोई क्या इंजरी हो गई थी, तो उससे क्या होता है, कुछ डैमेज होता है चारों तरफ ब्लैडर के, जिसकी वजह से आपको सिम्टम शुरू हो गए। जब सिम्टम शुरू हुए तो कितने सिवियर हैं, कितनी बार ऐसा होता है कि आपको लीकेज हो गया, और ये बराबर लीकेज होता रहता है कि इंटरमिटेंट होता, कभी हुआ कभी नहीं हुआ। ठीक है, देन क्या चीज़ से आपको ट्रिगर कर जाता है, जैसे आप शुरू में क्या होगा, अगर ब्लैडर वीकनेस है, खांसने से, छींकने से यूरिन निकल गई, फिर उसके बाद जब प्रॉब्लम बहुत ज़्यादा बढ़ जाती है तो बेड में ही लेटे लेटे अपनी पोजीशन बदली तो ही निकल गई, ज़रा सा लेटे से उठ के बैठे तो निकल गई, ज़रा सा भी एब्डोमेन में प्रेशर बढ़ा कि यूरिन लीकेज हो जाता है। तो फिर जब हमारे पास मिक्स प्रॉब्लम्स आती हैं तो हमें ये देखना होता है कि कौन सी बड़ी ज़्यादा प्रॉब्लम है उस, क्योंकि ट्रीटमेंट उसी के ऊपर बेस्ड होगा, और उसके साथ में और क्या क्या उसको अलग और प्रॉब्लम्स आ रही हैं। फिर उसके इस यूरिनरी लीकेज से, जैसे डॉक्टर रागिनी आपको बता रही थी कि वो जाना नहीं चाहते, बाहर जाना नहीं, निकलना नहीं चाहते, सेक्स में उनको हेजिटेशन, तो उनको इम्पैक्ट क्या क्या हो रहा है। पिछली स्लाइड पर जा सकते हैं क्या फिर से, कैन वी गो बैक टू द प्रीवियस स्लाइड प्लीज। prolapse along with it, and we should not forget about the bowel dysfunction. Sometimes, you know, there is constipation, impaction of stool, which is very easy to treat and it will resolve the problem. And then some of the medical problems, cancer of the pelvic organs has to be excluded. Then surgical history, what surgery they have had, have they been treated for incontinence before, or hysterectomy, pelvic prolapse, then spinal or central nervous system surgeries have been done. All these will have an impact on urinary symptoms. then menstrual history, of course, and obstetric and gynecological history, because you know, then you will find out why she has a damage to the pelvic floor. Then drug history, lots of drugs which can cause leakage, and if you know that they are on them, then you can stop or at least change the drug. Social history, so they are smoker, they have alcohol, they are drug abuse, so all these have to be excluded. Yeah, next slide, please. And we have the next slide, please. Yeah, so we shouldn't forget, just remember this acronym. Can we have the, go back to the previous slide? Who's controlling the slides?
Yeah, ma'am, aap aise hi bolo na.
Achha, कुछ रिवर्सिबल कॉजेज जो मैंने कहा एक्रोनिम था वो अच्छा था देख लेते वो डायपर करके है तो डेलीरी कैन यू शो अस द स्लाइड आई थिंक इट विल बी गुड फॉर देम
बैक मैम
या
डायपर इज अच्छा है
बैक
डायपर तो डेलीरियम इंफेक्शन एट्रोफिक यूरेथ्राइटिस फार्माकोलॉजिकल कॉजेज साइकोलॉजिकल कॉजेज excessive urine production, restricted mobility, and stool impaction. This is called diapers. So you remember these can be treatable and you can actually resolve the problem. Yeah, next slide, please. So we need to do this, we have done, right? Physical examination, I have already discussed it. You know, BMI is very important. Chronic cough, cardiovascular diseases, all these have to be, and neurological problems like dementia and Alzheimer's, all these can contribute. And post-void residual volume, the best way to measure post-void residual volume, you ask the patient to have a full bladder or comfortably full bladder, then see how much urine there is in the bladder, and then ask her to pass urine and then check again how much is left. So anything less than 100 or now they say up to 200 is okay, don't worry about it. But if it is beyond that, then there is a significant residual volume and we have to address that. Next slide, please. So voiding diary. Now this is a very good, see, I'll give you two examples of voiding diary, and they are very self-explanatory. If you see on the right, on the left side, she takes coffee, tea, cola. See how much tea and cola, all these caffeine can irritate the bladder and can cause leakage, right? And then the amount of intake, the next column is how much you drink. So you have a measuring cup and see how much water you have taken, how much tea you have taken, and you keep writing. If somebody takes 1500, 1600, 1700 milliliters in a day, her intake is fine. Now see how much urine she passes. So you see the next column is like this 200, then 300. So what is the bladder capacity? We want people to pass urine 400 to 500 or 300 to 500, maybe okay. But you know, she is passing very, very small amount, so 30 milliliter and 60 milliliter, and she had urgency. So the bladder got irritated and she leaked. Okay, and here again 80, 60, so small amount of urine is collecting. So this is telling me that I am dealing with the bladder problem, detrusor overactivity. And look at this one. Now, see that she is passing good amount of urine, holding good amount of urine. So her bladder is fine here. And there is no urgency preceding that. But when she lifted a box, she increased her abdominal pressure, laugh, jogging, coughing, and she had a leakage. Here you see leakage episodes. So this is very self-explanatory. It is telling me that I'm dealing with a bladder neck problem. So in summary, urine examination for all women, post-void residual volume for all women, urodynamics when considering invasive treatment for urinary incontinence, not before starting medic treatment, not before starting conservative management, and imaging and cystoscopy only in very select patients we need.
Thank you, madam. Very, very nicely explained. Everybody is benefited by this. And not only this, you have taken care of our non-medical friends also. explained, and this Viding diary is very, very important, which every doctor should understand if she wants to treat this woman. Because only on the Viding diary you can differentiate whether this patient is having a stress incontinence or a detrusor active in overactivity or a mixed type of thing. Over to Dr. Chandan.
Good evening and namaste to everybody. Our next question is to Dr. Vidya. Newlywed female came to OPD with complaint of pain in the lower abdomen, frequent urine and urgency, and by the time she reaches to loo, she leaks too. So this is a very, very common problem in all the OPDs, and all patients must have experienced it at some point of time. Ma'am, how do you treat this, and what will be your advice?
I will introduce you in one line. Dr. Vidya, she is the national chairperson of Food and Drug Committee of FOCSI, and she's from Bangalore. She's a head of department of the medical college. Over to
you. Thank you, Dr. Ragini and the team for involving me for this webinar. It is an excellent going. And I just want to answer this. Many times we get such type of patients, and whenever infection, and secondly, we commonly call this as a honeymoon cystitis, right? So what is urinary tract infection? Because urinary tract infection, urine hai, kidneys hota hai, wahan se ureter se bladder jo reservoir rehta hai, wahan pe urine collect hota hai, and then it comes out of that through small urethra. So this urinary tract infection can occur in the ureters, bladder, kidneys and urethra. So bladder infection ko hum cystitis bolte hain, aur urethral infection ko hum urethritis bolte hain, which is very, very common. So it can be a simple one or it can be a complicated. Simple urinary tract infection can occur in healthy people with normal urinary tracts. This occurs commonly and frequently in women. आप अगर देखना चाहते हो तो 40-60% ऑफ द वुमन विल एक्सपीरियंस एन यूरिनरी ट्रैक्ट इन्फेक्शन इन हर लाइफ टाइम. सो 1 in 4 विल एक्सपीरियंस अ रिपीट इन्फेक्शन एज वेल. सो ये क्यों होता है? क्योंकि दीज बैक्टीरियाज कम फ्रॉम द स्किन अराउंड योर यूरिनरी वजाइनल ओपनिंग विद द सेक्शुअल एक्टिविटी. इट हैव बी ऑल वुमेन दे हैव शॉर्टर यूरेथ्रा, and unfortunately this can be a perfect recipe for her urinary tract infection. And whenever a woman indulges with sex, it may push these bacteria in urethra where they creep into the bladder and stick around causing the infection. So this is a simple infection which we call it as a urinary tract infection. And complicated urinary tract infections means a recurrent infection can occur whenever there is an underlying medical conditions like diabetes or maybe antibiotic resistance, and they can lead to complicated urinary tract infections. Now, what is a symptomatic bacteriuria? So some individuals, they have bacteria in their urine, but there are no signs and symptoms. If you check their urine, you will find definitely there are bacteria or WBCs. These patients will not need antibiotic treatment, but it is very, very important to treat these patients in pregnancy because it can lead to complications in both mother and baby, like there may be fetal growth restriction, preterm delivery, and all other complications. And you know, it may lead to infection to the kidneys also in pregnancy. So you should be very, very careful in pregnancy if there is a asymptomatic bacteriuria. So what are the symptoms? What are the symptoms? Main is dysuria. Dysuria is a painful micturition. And as Ranjana ji ne itna acha bataya history mein kya kya aapko puchna chahiye, to dysuria is a first symptom. Secondly is a urinary urgency. So it is a urge incontinence and frequency. So bar bar pishab ko jana, painful urination, and sensation of bladder fullness. यूरिन पूरा निकल जाने के बाद भी आपको ब्लैडर फुल लगता है या लोअर एब्डोमिनल डिस्कम्फर्ट लगता है या पेनफुल लगता है नीचे की जगह. तो दैट इज दोज आर द ऑल सिम्टम्स. एंड व्हाट आर द साइंस? देयर मे बी पेन और यू मे फाइंड दैट यूरिन माइट बी ब्लडी. ब्लडी मीन्स हिमैचुरिया. देन देयर आर यू मे हैव फीवर, चिल्स and malaise, and these are the common symptoms with which the patients can come to us. Now, if how it develops, so urinary tract तो sterile रहता है हमेशा, but uncomplicated urinary tract infection can involve the bladder in a host without underlying the renal, metabolic or neurological diseases. Because of in women, it is as I have already explained, that is because of the short urethra, and it is nearness to the vaginal opening as well as anal opening. Now, bladder infections, most common bacteria are E. coli, then Klebsiella. Those are all bacteria. You just remember that E. coli is the commonest infection which you can have. And it usually inhabits the periurethral or vaginal introitus, and it ascends into the bladder through the urethra. Urethra is the outer opening of this from the bladder. Now, some people are at the higher risk of getting UTI, and because of I already the urethras are shorter and closer to rectum. And for this, you should always train your girls for the toilet training. How to train them? You should always wipe and wash from front to back. So these bacteria, they tend to hang around on anus. And if you wipe from front to back, especially after bowel movement, they are less likely to make it to the urethra. So always clean from the front to back. Now, what are the other factors? Other risk factors are previous urinary tract infection, then sexual activity, especially multiple sexual partners, and changes in the bacteria that live inside the vagina. That is a vaginal flora. That's why there is increasing various articles have been published about the probiotic use. So, for example, after menopause, and of course the use of condoms. They say that what is the evidence for condoms is non-lubricated latex condoms. What they happens is they increase the friction and irritate the skin of the woman during the sexual intercourse. So because of this, there is an increased risk of urinary tract infection. But they decrease the incidence of sexually transmitted infections. And secondly, if the condoms are coated with spermicides, they say that there is a 2 to 3 times greater risk for urinary tract infections. The spermicides were once thought to provide minimal protection against STDs such as chlamydia and gonorrhea, but they cause irritation of the vaginal surface and they may increase again the susceptibility to some of the STDs, especially HIVs. Okay, so these are the few things you should remember, what are the risk factors and how the condom is involved. So you should always think any patient where there is a pain in flank area or pain on the abdomen and pelvis, also you should ask the history of any vaginal discharge. So do not assume that every patient with dysuria is having a urinary tract infection. Always think of sexually transmitted diseases, related cervicitis, or any pelvic inflammatory disease also. So how you diagnose these urinary tract infections? One is a simple microscopic examination of the urine and urine culture. These two things will decide that you are having urine infections or not. So whenever there is a history of urinary tract instrumentation or recent exposure of antibiotics or recurrent infections or advanced age. So you have to collect the sample, early morning sample, and that too midstream sample of the urine should be given, otherwise it will be contaminated if you don't give this sample properly. So you have to submit this to the laboratory and as early as possible, because you should not keep it in the morning and give it in the afternoon, then the whole thing your report will be erroneous. Then what are the goals and consideration for the drug treatment? So after doing culture, many times what happens is urine microscopy will show more than 10 pustules. That definitely indicates that you are having infection. You have to send this urine sample for culture and sensitivity. But before that, your doctor may start you on antibiotics. And what are our goals is, one is symptomatic relief and to prevent the complication for ascending infection to the kidneys. And we want to eradicate total infection. So early treatment is always given. Once we give the urine for culture, we start the antibiotics. But if you give the urine culture after giving antibiotics, then many times the culture report may come as a sterile one. So early treatment, why it is recommended? Because it will progress to the, many times in diabetic patients or any other patients, the progression can go to pyelonephritis, which is a kidney infection. So what you should do is urine analysis. Already Ranjana has told nicely. So I'll not go into the detail of urine analysis, how it is done, and all those things. What our goals of management is to keep the bacteria out of system. So say goodbye to the burning, frequent urination, or other any unpleasant symptoms. Start with these changes. One is hydration. Hydration is drink plenty of water and relieve yourself often. So drink water and relieve. You simplest way is to flush bacteria out of bladder and urinary tract before it can settle in. If you are well hydrated, it will be very tough to go along without going to the bathroom. So wash up before sex. Use soap and water before sex. This will keep bacteria away from urethra. And peeing means urinate after every sexual intercourse. Avoid use of spermicide and wipe from front to back. Okay. So these are the behavioral modification you should do. And prevention is better than cure. So always see that even if you don't have urinary tract infection, I always tell all the women to hydrate properly. At least minimum drink 6 to 8 glasses of water every day. Okay. So minimize douching, sprays, powders in the genital area. And always teach your girls whenever you are potty training to wipe from front to back. Okay, what about the cranberries? Many people, they drink this cranberry. This cranberry contains one small thing, that is proanthocyanidins. It has got an anti-adhesive activity on the bacterial fimbriae. So it is proven beyond doubt. It has been published in the Cochrane data also. So what it does is it interferes with the adhesiveness of these uropathogenic bacteria to the bladder epithelium. That is its a nice thing, and it doesn't it causes any adverse effects or any resistance. Okay, so other management is our pharmacological treatment. Okay, so there are first line treatment, second line treatment, and alternative therapy. That will be given by your doctors according to the culture and sensitivity of your report. There are newer antibiotics which have come. We have used so many things, but the most commonly we are now using nitrofurantoin and fosfomycin, which is always a first line treatment. One thing I want to tell you is whatever antibiotics are given to you, you should complete them. Means for first 3 days or 7 days, whatever is given. And then again, come back to your doctor and again, repeat examination should be done for the microscopy and culture. Otherwise, the antibiotic resistance is the first thing for the recurrent urinary tract infection. I hope I have done little justice to my topic. Otherwise, it is very vast topic. And I thank Ragini to taking up in this one. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very crisp and very, very good. Thank you. There's one question, ma'am, related to this only. That is if the culture is sterile,
yeah,
the patient is symptomatic, what to do?
Yeah. No. Culture, many times it happens that the patient give the urine sample after they start antibiotics. Okay. And it comes sterile. And if the patient is symptomatic, they have to complete these antibiotics. And they have to hydrate themselves. And some urinary analgesic, like we give the pyridium and all that will ease their problem. Or if something else might be there with urinary vaginal tract infection, it may be vaginal infections also. Means that has to be examined. You have to do speculum examination, cervicitis, vaginitis are to be ruled out. Then you have to send for that treatment also should be done if we suspect the sexually transmitted diseases as well.
Thank you very much.
Sometimes these patients which come with a sterile urine report but have a symptom, we have to think something out of box also.
Yeah.
It's not the common infection which we send, because mostly they went for the aerobic infection. Maybe she is suffering from the
fungal infections. Yeah.
Sometimes and the most important thing is interstitial cystitis. Usually forget. I will ask Dr. Aranya Sharma to give a 2 line on this only, madam, 2 line, because we are going very short of the time. Okay. 2 line on this interstitial cystitis, which is very important and we usually neglect.
Yeah. So, some people have urgency, frequency, we already talked about, but some people have urgency, frequency, that's every half an hour, every 10 minutes, 15 minutes, they have to rush to the toilet. And what I said before, they are rushing to the toilet because they are scared they will leak. That's why they rush to the toilet if there is a bladder problem or overactivity. But interstitial cystitis, what Dr. Ragini has mentioned, that means, you know, that they pass urine because they are in pain. So a little bit of urine that collects in the bladder gives them so much pain that they go and pass urine. And they change doctors because everybody thinks they have a UTI, urinary tract infection. They are given a course of antibiotics. They sometimes a little bit marginally better, but sometimes they are the same. They leave one doctor, they go to another doctor, and the studies show that it takes 7 years minimum to get to the right diagnosis. And then they are diagnosed as interstitial cystitis. So whoever comes across like this. So what Chandan asked me, you know, see, what your question is, that if the culture is sterile, does she still have an infection? So there can be an infection, as Dr. Ragini said. It could be tuberculosis, chlamydia, lots of bacteria, anaerobic. Or there could be no, but then your routine examination is very important. It will show pus cells, it will show nitrate positive, leukocyte esterase positive. All this you have to take into consideration. If all that is not there, then interstitial cystitis, who's coming again and again to you, you know, please keep that in mind and refer to the patient to the right people who understand how to treat interstitial cystitis.
There is an association called as GIBS, I think.
So we are founder members of GIBS.
Okay.
We are actually founder members of GIBS.
And Dr. Ranjana is the core executive
of GIBS. Because I know that, because they try to associate with gynecologists, because gynecologists are very often the first people who see them. And if we don't know about this concept of interstitial cystitis, like you said, they keep moving from one gynec to another or one doctor to another. So that is just wanted.
For that, I invite you all on the 17th July. I will send a link for that GIPS. Today, we will stick to urinary incontinence.
Okay.
Yeah. So my next question, or I can say a case, a very, very real case, many women silently suffering from this and having this problem. Mrs. N, 43 years, homemaker, enters your chamber. She had two vaginal deliveries. Both of her babies were heavy, 3.8 and 3.6 kg, a difficult delivery, and she was very upset. And she said and said, "Doctor, my life is a hell. I can't do anything. And if I laugh, I sneeze, I stand, I just leak. I can't wear a pant. I have to wear either a skirt or Indian dresses. So my pant is covered all the time. Many times I have used panty liner. I have to change my clothes. Even many times I really stink with the urine. So Dr. Ashla, Dr. Ashla is one of the biggest institute of Delhi, Safdarjung Hospital. She's a special interest in the urogyne. Madam, evaluation is done by Dr. Ranjana. And after seeing everything, I think this patient is suffering from stress urinary incontinence. I'm a ordinary gynecologist. I'm referring that patient to you for your special management. How you will treat this case?
Before I say how you will treat this case, of course, we must recapitulate whatever Ranjana has said. This is time to put that into practice, because a woman says she leaks on coughing, sneezing, and you diagnose SUI is not correct. She has, because bladder is a very poor witness. What symptoms you have may not be what you actually have. And Ranjana has very nicely said everything that you have to keep in mind, that she may have been taking some drugs which are causing this. She may be having diabetes or some neurological problem. She may be having a, you know, overflow incontinence, which she thinks that she has incontinence only on coughing, sneezing, but maybe the problem is something else. So everything in total, the history is the most important thing in diagnosing the type of incontinence. That will tell, give you a big clue. So I don't think I need to go in details, but just this case is putting what Ranjana has said into practice, that to take all the history, the her distress, her quality of life, so that you can decide what treatment you would give her after deciding how much is the extent of problem. So like you said, that after assessing completely, that will, you know, when we say that patient has SUI, means you have made the patient lie down on your examination table with a comfortably full bladder, not over full, and then you ask her to cough. Once you ask her to cough and you are able to see, demonstrate incontinence, then you can say for sure that she has urinary stress, urinary incontinence. And then also this incontinence, you also have to classify what is the severity, because this patient has incontinence on coughing, sneezing. So they are graded into three: slight incontinence, and incontinence on, you know, even slight exertion. And third is when she even changes posture and she has incontinence. Then we know what is the etiology, because the type three, grade three is mainly because of her sphincter is defective. And grade one and two can be because of the, you know, damage and urethral movement outside the abdomen. Now, also, you have to classify this incontinence into whether it is a previous life, whether it is a complicated or it is a simple. A patient who has nothing else, she just comes to you, she says that she has this incontinence, you have taken the history and you've done the examination, you don't find any prolapse, you don't find any symptoms of voiding difficulties, you don't find any diabetes, you don't find any recurrent UTI. This is a simple stress urinary incontinence, but she has any other problem, then it is complicated. So your evaluation will go further. Like Ranjana has already said, the evaluation doesn't stop at this. The first thing is, of course, the history, the voiding diary, urine examination, post-void. And after that, if she has a complicated SUI, then you have to further evaluate. Maybe she'll require imaging. Ultrasound has come as a very good modality now to diagnose incontinence, especially the hypermobility. You can do a very simply, when you're doing a post-void, you can also do a transperineal ultrasound and you can see whether the urethra is hypermobile and what is the degree. So after having evaluated everything, you can classify the patient into a simple or complicated. And the simple incontinence, or if she has mixed symptom, mixed incontinence, the first line treatment is of course conservative. Unless she has so much problem that even on movement she is having incontinence. So, and conservative treatments are, first of all, if she's fat, she has to reduce her weight. And the bladder diary, what Ranjana has said, will give you a clue to her lifestyle and whatever she is taking, what she should omit, what should you take. This next thing is exercises. And then second line is drugs. And of course, for short term, there are devices which can control incontinence, like somebody has to go for a meeting and she is not yet cured. So there are devices, I don't think they're available in India, but there are plugs which can be put so that for the short time, they can have those. And there are, these are the mechanical devices. So otherwise, if not cured by that, then she has to go for surgical.
So surgical comes later. Usually patient is not ready for the medicine or surgery, and first step they always want something else. And we all know that childbirth trauma and aging relaxes that area, the muscle become weak and the fascia become weak, and there's a big role of the pelvic physiotherapy for that. I myself is a very great fan of the pelvic physiotherapy, especially in this pelvic physiotherapy we introduce just after delivery to the woman, because post-delivery rehabilitation is not usually done by us. We don't focus on that. And that is the exact period a patient, every woman has a post-delivery rehabilitation and pelvic floor training. Not only that, during antenatal exercise, these problems will really decrease. So Dr. Ranjana, over to you again. In short, please elaborate these conservative treatments in very short. And then we'll go again to Dr. Ashla for its medical and surgical treatment.
Okay. All right. So when the patient comes to me, first thing I want to find out how I can help this this woman without introducing medicines and, you know, offering her surgical treatment and all that. So when I see her, you know, I asked, you know, I have asked her to do the black, you know, this voiding diary, which will tell me how is her fluid intake. So sometimes, you know, simple measures, you know, ask, she's drinking so much, 5 glasses of water in the morning and 2-3 glasses before going to bed. And then she complains that all the time in the morning till afternoon, she is rushing to the toilet. So fluid management is very important. They don't have to take 5 glasses of water in the morning and ask them not to have anything to drink or eat for 2 to 3 hours before going to bed. If they are smokers, ask them to stop smoking and tell them what all can irritate the bladder. And alcohol is also, you know, causes diuresis, lot of urine formation, and they keep rushing. All this they can do themselves. If they are overweight, because, you know, any BMI more than 30 is going to contribute to all the problem. So they should start exercising and, you know, they start watching what they eat. So they reduce. So this, so or medication, any medication which I can, you know, stop, I will ask them to do pelvic floor exercises. And what pelvic, how they, see, it's simple, like Mool Bandh, right, in yoga. So they see what you have to squeeze your anal muscles, your vaginal muscles. So you can train them when you are doing a vaginal examination, put your 2 fingers in the vagina and ask the patient to squeeze your fingers. So they know which muscles they have to contract. So they can do 10 times at a time, squeeze, stay there for 10 seconds, count to 10 and release. Squeeze, lift it up, lift the pelvic floor up, count to 10 and release. They can do it while standing, sitting, lying down, anytime, waiting for a bus. So they can do 10 times in a go and 3-4 times whenever they remember in a day, they should keep doing it. This sometimes, once they know which muscles to contract, they will be able to do it. But it is easier said than done. See, lots of times, you know, you tell them to do it, they haven't done it. All right. And they think, you know, there is no, they can't see a positive result, so they leave it. So you have to tell them to try for 3 months at least, because it's the muscle strengthening exercise. So you have to give time for your muscle to strengthen. So 3 months trying, and if that doesn't help, lots of women will come back that it doesn't help. If they don't know which muscles to contract, you can help them by biofeedback. So there is a meter. So when they contract their muscles, it shows, you know, a deflection in the meter. So they know that they are doing the right thing. So that will give them more stimulus to do it even more. So pelvic floor exercises they can do. They can change lifestyle, their lifestyle modification they can do. They can actually use pads. So they are scared to go out, ask them to use pads, ask them not to hold urine for too long. So ask them to pass urine every 2.5 to 3 hours. And then there are rings available, see, that like pessaries. So these pessaries can be tried. And if the pessaries work, we know that, you know, there is a little bit of lifting of the bladder neck, and then a little bit of constriction is helping them. So they can use the pessaries, or they can use just a tampon. If they are going out, they can put a tampon inside and they can at least prevent the leakage, right? And they can also try these pessaries, but these pessaries are not for a very long-term use. So if they are basically young people, distressed urinary incontinence people are usually young people. They have a lot of life left. So if they are going to benefit by medication or surgery, we will go ahead and also advise them. Now, weighted cones you have seen. So we put we put one cone, and then if they can retain that cone, after some time, you can increase the weight of the cone. So that cone also they can retain. So then they can go to a further. So weighted cones can be used one by one in a serial, in a sequence. Then bladder training. So bladder training, shall I mention the bladder training here?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Okay. But so bladder training is really very useful. So ask them to see their bladder diary, how frequently they are rushing to the toilet. So your initial interval will be decided on their bladder diary. So if they can hold urine for one and a half hours, so start with 1-1.5 hours. So ask them to void or pass urine by the clock. Ghadi mein dekh ke every 1.5 hours, they have to go to the toilet. They can't go before 1.5 hours. If they leak, it's all right. So ask them to wait until they leak or they reach 1.5 hours. For a week, you try that. Once they have reached one and a half hours and with confidence, they say, oh, 1.5 hours, I don't have to rush to the toilet. And then you increase by 1/2 hour. So next week, they will do 2 hours. Same thing. And then 2.5 hours. If you reach 2.5 hours, that's normal voiding pattern. So 2.5 to 3 hours. So that you have achieved the goal. They should meet other people, other patients who have been successful in this sort of treatment. So they just give them encouragement, and all the nurses and doctors in the clinic should encourage women to do it because they need a lot of encouragement for that. Thank you.
So as far as conservative treatment is concerned, it is onus is on you as a woman, because you have to do it religiously, and it needs time, it needs dedication, only then, and right type of exercise, only then it causes the effect on you. Kegel exercise hum log bata dete hain, wo sirf pet hilane se nahi hota hai. The right kind of exercise, Kegel is very, very necessary. And sometime, even after doing the Kegel, because they're such a small muscles, they don't become active. And what type of pressure it needs, this instrument which I have shown you, the Kegel Master, it is available on the Amazon. And it gives a pressure, against that pressure, that muscles contract and releases. So it is very important. Then biofeedback, as I said, now everything Mrs. N has done, but has failed. So she came back again to Dr. Ashla and said, Madam, I have come to the hospital so bad. Now tell me what you will do. So Dr. Ashla, what will be the next step of the treatment for these women you are going to do for this? Madam, unmute kariye apne ko.
After the conservative treatment has failed, and by failed, I mean, actually, she has done it. You have to find out whether she has done her exercises or not, because it's very difficult. It's very easier said than done that you do it 10 times, 8 times, 3 times a day, but women normally don't do it. The first thing is the counseling is very important, to tell them that we can even show them the evidence of all the societies of urogynecology of the world. They have given good evidence that if it is done for 3 months, 8 times, in 3 times a day, it will give results. So if they fail, then medical management can be given, but that is only to be given while they are taking their, doing their exercises and for short-term use, because nobody can take medical management for very long because of the side effects. For SUI, various drugs were used earlier, but they have not found to be beneficial. But duloxetine is one drug which, now what it does is it increases those things which will cause contraction of the bladder neck. So it helps, but patients always leave it after some time. They can't take it for long term. So it is always a short gap management. You can't be on it for lifelong while she is doing her exercises to give her relief, or while she is waiting for surgery to give her relief, you can use it. And then when she's not relieved and she's really troubled, like the patient Ragini had described, that her life is, really miserable, then we have surgical options. Now, the surgical options have to be chosen with care. You have to decide which patient will need what surgery. Like I said earlier, that we have grades of SUI, grade 1 to mild, moderate and severe. Now, when you are giving conservative option, you don't have to do further investigations once you've diagnosed SUI. But when you decide for a surgical option, I think it is a good idea to get urodynamics done to see that what we are dealing with, and also an ultrasound, transperineal ultrasound, to see what is the mobility like. If we have a case of hypermobility, then depending upon your expertise, if you are going to do it, then you should do what you can do best and not do what everybody else is doing, because this is a condition which is really making the woman vulnerable, and the first surgery is the best surgery. After that, it becomes very difficult to, you know, do second surgery for incontinence. So we have open procedures like Bush retropubic urethropexy. We have, which can be done by open method or by laparoscopy, whatever you are more comfortable with. Laparoscopy really needs a lot of expertise for doing Bush. Then we have slings, which are, you know, commercially available. We have TOT, we have TVT. Then we have, you know, these tapes, they are put in the mid urethra. What they do is they elevate the urethra. First, already been explained that the pathophysiology of SUI is that urethra has fallen out of its place. So the abdominal pressure is not transmitted. By putting these slings, we are making it again higher intra-abdominal so that the pressure equalizes. But then we have TVT and we have TVTO. TVT is transvaginal and TOT is through the obturator. They're actually the same, but the indications are different. Normally, in a simple SUI, TOT would be okay. But a patient who has intrinsic deficiency, TOT is not going to help. So just a patient comes with SUI, you put a TOT, you cause more problems. So you have to see that she doesn't have intrinsic sphincter deficiency, which you have tested by urodynamic. Then only you will put TOT. Otherwise, she may go in for either the pubourethral slings or for TVT. Next slide. The pubourethral slings, they can be, next slide, Ragni. They can be, you know, these suburethral slings can be autologous, which are better. Like you can take it from the thigh fascia lata, or you can take it from the rectus muscle by giving a incision and taking out the rectus sheath. So that you, the principle is same. You're putting it under the urethra to elevate the urethra. So what you do now, there are proponents who say that you should not be using any of these meshes and you should only use autologous material, but then still the debate is going on. The gold standard. The gold standard is Bursch Colpus suspension. What we do is that the principle is again the same. You're lifting the urethra up by putting sutures, which you tie to the Cooper's ligament. So you can do it abdominally or you can do it laparoscopically, and some people even do it vaginally. Basically, when you see the cure rates of all these surgical positions, you will find that the short-term cure rate of Bursch is 90%. Long-term is 84%. And 5% of them will get voiding dysfunction. While TOT, TVT, the cure rates are 85 to 90%. Long-term is also 83%. And voiding difficulties are seen in 8%. Now, we have Cayley's. What about Cayley's? People are doing with vaginal hysterectomy Cayley's repair. Now, Cayley's repair can cure SUI, but what is the long-term outcome of this? Initially, 65% of the patient may be cured, but long-term, it has been seen that 30% cure or 35% cure rate. That's why it has disappeared out of the textbook as a treatment of SUI. And then we have, you know, intrinsic deficiency, these tapes may not help and these people may need to be put with some injections which are put either intraurethrally or paraurethrally. These injections are, what they do is they will just make the urethra leak and increase the pressure at the outlet so that the urine doesn't leak, but they have to be given repeatedly. And of course, there is a chance of infection when you're doing something repeatedly. And they are less effective than conventional surgery. And the woman, when she is counseled that she is being given this, she has to be told that it has to be repeated. And then if nothing happens, probably we don't have it in India. You can have an artificial sphincter, which you can inflate and deflate at your will. When you want to hold urine, you keep it inflated. And when you want to pass urine, you deflate and the cuff gets deflated and you pass urine. So we have a lot of options, but then it has to be chosen very wisely.
So as Dr. Ashla, thank you so much. She has explained the main message. What I understand is if urinary leakage ek bar shuru ho gaya, तो 100% इज वेरी वेरी डिफिकल्ट कि उसको ठीक किया जा सकता है. इवन आफ्टर ट्रीटमेंट टुडे यू हैव गॉट 100% रिजल्ट विद द पैसेज ऑफ द टाइम इट कैन डिक्रीज. सो द प्रिवेंशन इज ऑलवेज बेटर देन क्योर. दैट मीन्स द कंजर्वेटिव ट्रीटमेंट अलॉन्ग विद योर हेल्थ, योर कोर मसल डेवलपमेंट, योर पेल्विक मसल डेवलपमेंट, मेंटेनिंग और योर वेट, योर डाइट, योर एक्सरसाइज, दैट इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. एंड नॉट ओनली दिस, अ टाइम ऑफ डिलीवरी, इफ यू आर वेरी, योर कोर मसल इज वेरी गुड एट द टाइम ऑफ डिलीवरी, इवन आफ्टर वजाइनल बर्थ यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू हैव सो मच अ प्रॉब्लम लाइक SUI और दिस थिंग, बिकॉज एट दैट टाइम द बर्थ ट्रामा एंड आफ्टर दैट द फेलिंग हारमोन्स, दे विल अफेक्ट ईच एंड एवरी वुमेन. इट ऑल डिपेंड्स हाउ मच डिग्री ऑफ द SUI or other type of urge incontinence you are going to have, but 25 to 30, even more than that, women suffers from this, and we have to do something for them. Now over to Dr. Chandan.
Next to the patient, ma'am, can you please flip the slide? So the patient has
very simple to say, as Dr. Archila has said, that woman has a pure stress incontinence. Even sometime before going for surgery, she needs to specific investigations, as Dr. Ranjana and Dr. Achala both have mentioned, uroflowimetry or urodynamics studies.
Excellent. So the this patient has gone to so many gynecologists now. She has heard about, we have heard about urodynamics and uroflowimetry. Now the Dr. Raman is with us, and he's a young dynamic urologist from Gurgaon. Dr. Raman, these tests are not available in all the gynae clinics. So now she's referred to you. So can you, in simple words, describe about this urodynamics and uroflowimetry? Dr. Raman?
Sure, ma'am. I will help you all with the specific tests on urology. But before that, just want to clarify two things that our previous speakers have said.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Achala, we have the artificial sphincter available in India. We have put it ourselves. It's still in my office, a sample. I wish I could show you, and you know. But then, basically, it's about 6 lakh rupees, the cost of that sphincter. And then, of course, surgery, when it's added, it becomes a huge financial burden for the patient. But it is the gold standard for patients who have an intrinsic sphincter deficiency. We put it usually for males, more commonly because there's a lot of incontinence patients who happen to have after their prostate removal. So that's where we use it. We've also tried debulking surgeries, the debulking agent being injected. So we used to inject deflux earlier for patients who had mild to moderate incontinence because of intrinsic sphincter deficiency. Again, in patients mainly for prostate cancer, but also in females. It works very well for the if the deficiency is just mild to moderate. But if the deficiency is very severe and there's a lot of leakage, then the sphincter becomes the gold standard for treatment. And it can be offered. You can always let me know if you need any help in that. So let's come back to the topic, uroflowimetry and urodynamics. So as we have discovered in this entire beautiful series of patient education and doctor education also, that we have to understand what kind of leakage is there. Unless we know the root cause of the leakage, whether it's because of the bladder being very
Atula?
Overactive, that it is because of the sphincter not being able to resist the pressures that the bladder is causing, or if it is just because of overflow incontinence, which means that the bladder is filled and it is not emptying itself well. These all forms of incontinence can present with the same symptoms, but if you want the right treatment for them, we have to understand why the incontinence is happening in the first place. So to precisely understand them, there are very two good tests available, which one of them is called uroflowimetry and the other is called urodynamics. So in the uroflowimetry test, what we have to do is when the patient comes, the patient has to sit in a commode, as you can see in the picture on the slide, and they just have to pass urine normally like they would. Now in this, they have to fill the bladder to a certain extent. They don't have to overperform or fill it too much because that also causes a problem with the results. But just like they would want to go to washroom, the usual pressure at which they go, they have to try to simulate the same kind of a environment as if they were going to pass urine in their home, and they would sit in the commode and they would pass urine, and then below there is a uroflowmeter which measures how well the urine has been passed. So now we can see the speed of the flow with this, we can see the pattern of the flow, we can see what is the capacity of the bladder. So sometimes the patient are not able to bring a very good bladder diary to the doctor. So it becomes important to understand whether the bladder is very small and that's why it's not able to hold urine and the patient often leaks, or is it because the bladder is not contracting at all, and it is just that, just like you would have a matka which will dribble, jisko hum kehte hain ki chhalak jata hai kabhi kabhi pani, isi tarah se we can have incontinence, which is called overflow incontinence, and we can need to understand how the well the bladder is working. So the pattern of flow can give us a good idea about it, the capacity of the bladder can give us a good idea about it, and this is a test where you can do a preliminary bladder function assessment without putting anything inside the patient. So these kind of tests, we call them non-invasive tests, which means that we are not doing touching anything inside the body, we're not introducing anything inside the body, we are doing a routine thing that the patient would normally do and test it. So this gives us an idea about the likely pathology. So ma'am, I just wanted to focus on the various graphs that we get in the uroflowmetry curves once. So normally when a patient would pass urine, we will get a hill shaped curve, which is the one which we see in the first A diagram. So that's a hill shaped curve, which means that you start to pass urine, the slowly the volume rises, and subsequently when the maximum pressure has reached, then it will fall. So this is the normal curve that we get. Along with that, sometimes we can attach an EMG electrode, which is again a non-invasive thing. We just have some stickers which we have to attach in the perineum. And we get to see how well the patient has relaxed the pelvic floor while we have done the uroflowmetry. Now this is again available at very few centers. We are lucky to have EMG with us along with uroflow. The second pattern that we see in which the patient has a very staggered kind of a graph, which means that the patient's bladder is working, but she has to put an extra force with her abdominal muscles, which are kind of diffusing the smooth contour of the typical uroflowmetric curve. And what is happening is we are seeing the saw-like pattern. So patient is using her muscles of the abdomen to pass urine out because the bladder probably is not working well, or there is some sort of a resistance because of which she has to put in extra pressure to overcome that resistance. And then we have a D-type curve wherein we see that the curve is rising and falling and rising and falling. And this kind of a thing happens when the bladder is intrinsically weak, when the muscles are not working. And it is solely the abdominal muscles or the muscles of the tummy, which the patient has to use to pass the urine. Then we have a low flow curve, as we can see in the E picture, wherein the curve hasn't gone as high as it should, and it is just a very feeble curve. And then we can sometimes have a super voiding pattern, which means that the bladder is too anxious to pass urine and it suddenly passes urine in a spurt. And this kind of a pattern is called a super voiding pattern. It could indicate some sort of a bladder overactivity or a sphincter deficiency. So once we have had an idea about how the patient is passing urine, and if we can figure out what kind of incontinence it is, then we go for a urodynamic study. But how to do that? First, you have to make sure that, you know, the stress picture would usually be that of a single quick spike going towards the super voiding sort of a thing. And a neurogenic bladder wherein we have an overflow incontinence, but have a curve going up, down, that curve. And if we have an intrinsic sphincter deficiency, again, we can have a super voiding kind of a curve. Suddenly there's a swoosh of urine and then it empties. So since, as we've seen that this is a very basic test, uroflowmetry, we have to certain times go for a very advanced test, which is called the urodynamics test. Now in this test, what we have to do is that we have to check the pressure in the bladder individually and separate it from the pressure of the abdomen. Because as we saw in the uroflowmetry, we can see both the bladder pressure and the abdominal pressure coming together as one graph. We are not able to separate the two pressures. So the test to do that is called urodynamics. Now, this is a 1 hour test. And Dr. Ranjana pointed out about this test and she said that a technician can also do it. But I would never recommend that a technician should be, you know, given the charge of doing such an important test, which is basically a treasure trove to find out exactly the main mechanism of the problem of the patient. So ideally, I do it myself in my center. And it takes a little while, but it is worth it because then you get to know certain small things which a technician may not tell you, or sometimes, you know, you may want to repeat a few actions that the patient might have missed, and it's always better to do it yourself. So this is a gold standard test to see how the bladder is working. We put two small catheters in the urine passage. They are very fine catheters. It's a painless process. And we put one catheter in the rectum or the vagina, which transmits the pressure of the entire abdomen. So I know that this kind of explanation would not be very helpful to the patients because there's a little technicality involved in the entire process, but I'll still try to keep it as layman as possible. So basically what we do is we start to fill in the bladder with some external fluid, the same fluid that we will give through the veins. So it's called normal saline that we use. And we fill it at a particular rate and we see how the bladder reacts to the filling of fluid inside it. And this entire part is called the storage phase. So we basically want to see how well the bladder stores. Sometimes in this phase, what we will see is that the bladder doesn't store very well. It starts to contract by itself. This is called an overactive bladder, and it's an important reason why there may be a stress incontinence or there could be an incontinence. So overactive bladder is something which we want to see in the storage phase. After that, once we have seen how well the bladder works, how well it senses the urine, then basically we go to the voiding phase. So in the various graphs, there is an attempt to show how the urination takes place. So as we can see that we are measuring different pressures here. So the first pressure that we can see is a PVS, or the pressure in the bladder as a whole. Then we have an abdominal pressure called PABD. That's the second line of the graph. And then we have the PDET, or the detrusor muscle pressure, which is the pressure of the muscles of the bladder. And then we have a line which tells the volume infused. How much is the bladder being able to hold urine? That is what we get an idea of. Then we have a Q wall, which means that it's the measure of how much the urine patient has passed after the test in the voiding phase. And we have a uroflowmetry along with it, which tells how well has been the rate of flow of the patient. So here we can see four graphs in this slide. I will just, for the benefit of the gynecologist, I would just give a brief intro on the various scenarios in this. Ma'am, we would still like to stay on the same slide with the four graphs. So basically, in the first graph, we can see that this is almost a terminal detrusor overactivity. Here, what is happening is that when we fill the urine to a particular extent, suddenly there has been an increase in the detrusor pressure. The PDET, the black line that we see in the first graph, has suddenly risen. And so has the vesicle pressure. So this means this is not voluntary, because right now we didn't ask the patient to, you know, voluntarily pass urine. This has happened without her knowledge, without the knowledge of the patient. Suddenly she felt that some urine has leaked and it was not in her control. Now this is called an overactive bladder with a terminal detrusor overactivity, which means that she has passed almost the entire amount of urine and emptied her bladder. This is a miserable situation because the leakage is so much that it becomes socially quite inept and awkward. The second graph that we see here is something which reflects an obstruction. So here we are seeing that the detrusor pressure rises too much. So we've seen that there is no abdominal straining happening, but the black line has risen to a very high level above 100 centimeters of water. This means that the bladder has contracted so hard. So it's got into the habit of, you know, really contracting too hard, because the outlet, the urine passage, has become very narrow and the bladder has to put a lot of pressure to overcome the pressure, the resistance of the outlet. The third graph that we see here is again that of overactive bladder, but this is not a terminal overactivity. Here we can see small spikes of detrusor coming in between. So in the third graph, we see the black line shows that often there is a spike in the bladder muscle. This is again without the will of the patient. So this is a graph showing an overactive bladder. And lastly, I've tried to accommodate a normal curve. So this is how a normal curve looks. Normally, there is no activity in the detrusor when we are filling the bladder. But when we ask the patient to pass urine, then her detrusor muscle contracts and the patient is able to pass urine with some sort of a curve. Now, let us understand, just for the medical personnel involved in this webinar as the audience, what is the role of these advanced tests? And when you should be referring. So this is a guideline by the Urological Society of India. We have a separate committee which basically works on female and functional urology, which includes a lot of urologists who are ladies, and we have certain guidelines from them. So we should carry out the clinical evaluation first to understand what kind of urinary incontinence is there. This is the clinical principle of treating any patient with leakage. So we have to understand whether it is a stress incontinence, is it an urge incontinence, is it a mixed incontinence, or one which is because of overflow due to chronic retention. So there are four main reasons, and we have to understand what reason is the cause of. Unless we find out the reason, we cannot give the patient the right treatment. The second thing that the entire guidelines committee says is that we should have a baseline clinical evaluation. We should properly ask the patient about what the symptoms are. We have to examine the patient. We have to see how much the bother is there, as the speakers earlier pointed. We have to do a complete urine examination. We have to make a voiding diary, and we have to see how much urine remains inside the bladder after the patient has passed in. This is a very important thing that we often can miss. We do not perform any urodynamic testing before initiating any non-invasive treatment. So basically, if you just want to start medical therapy, you don't need such an advanced test as a urodynamics. You can always start the patient on medicines initially when the patient comes and follow her up and get the test done meanwhile. We can also omit urodynamic study if we are doing an uncomplicated stress urinary incontinence management. And all other women should undergo urodynamics before the stress incontinence surgery. So that's very important. The urodynamics has a very good role before surgery. It should be recommended. And the last point of the slide, ma'am, can we be on the previous slide? The last very important point on urodynamics is that in men and women with urge incontinence, before we plan anything invasive, we should get a urodynamics. So urodynamics definitely has a role. I'm quite sorry to say that I do not get as many referrals for urodynamics as are ideally suited. And ideally, with these guidelines in place and with so many well-educated and informed doctors dealing with the situation, I should actually not get time to do any of my urological procedures. But then I think there is a need for more awareness on this, and urodynamics definitely is the way to better treat our patients, to give them the optimal gynecological care that they would deserve.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raman. That was a very simplified way of making us understand what urodynamics and uroflowmetry is about. Yes, ma'am.
I have put these two, urodynamic and uroflowmetry. It is to understand the society that most of the test, which is little costly, but why it is written by the doctors, why it is referred one doctor to another doctor, because without these tests, it is very difficult to treat them. Many a time when we are going to a second line of treatment, say sacral modulation, Botox or something like that, before that, it is very, very necessary, as Dr. Archila has also said, ki before jumping for operation, we have to be very sure what we are going to operate. Without these uroflowmetry or urodynamics, if it is not a straight case, it is very difficult. So many urogynecologists, which is a new subspecialty, they are being trained, or they are already trained and they are doing this thing, but those urogynecologists are very less in number. Mostly gynecologists is still a general gynecologist, and they have to gradually understand this thing, and timely referral is the best thing, whether it is a urogynecologist or a urologist, and do a proper treatment for our women. Because at the end of the day, it is the treatment and it is the happiness of the woman which is matter to us up to a great extent. So now coming to the next, after this urodynamic studies, now Mrs. N is diagnosed with mixed incontinence, and during evaluations, she turned out diabetic too. Dr. Nagarkitti is a national committee chairperson for menopause of Foxy. Please explain her what is mixed incontinence and how you will treat this patient of urge incontinence, special focus on the medical management. Dr. Nagarkitti.
Thank you, madam. At the outset, I wish to thank Dr. Ragini Agarwal, madam, for inviting me here to this webinar, which is something which is also like a public forum where even non-doctors are also part of the program to understand this problem. And I would also like to thank all the other participants who have already given so much of overview into this problem. Now, what I have been asked to explain is this patient who has what is also called as overactive bladder, wherein basically there are a combination of urgency, frequency, and sometimes nocturia. So basically there's a very strong and sudden desire to pass urine, even with the bladder not being full. And that is what is the main pathology in the overactive bladder. And sometimes as soon as she gets the urge, there is an involuntary loss of urine. And that, like Dr. Raman said, is very, sometimes a very large quantity. In fact, that is some way to differentiate it from the stress incontinence. In the stress incontinence, whenever there is a sudden increase in the pressure, like she coughs or she, she makes some kind of an effort, there is a small leakage of urine. But in urge incontinence, there is a sudden large bolus of leakage. So it makes it really, very embarrassing for the patient. And because of that, very often there are social problems. There are problems related to her work. And she's not able to concentrate, even sexual problems what Dr. Ranjana said, these problems can be there. So therefore now the management can be, one is the, before going into the drugs, I would just like to say that there is also the behavioral therapy, which is important. Can I just go to the previous slide, madam?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, so behavioral therapy, which is very important, and it should be the first line therapy in all these patients of overactive bladder. In fact, for behavioral therapy, one does not need to even do the special tests like urodynamic study, etc. So this is mainly like bladder training, bladder control. Like they should be trained to increase the resistance of the bladder. Pelvic floor muscles, everyone has already explained about the pelvic floor muscles, the Kegels exercises. So that should be stressed to the patient always. Fluid management, how to control the fluids. Again, this has also been explained both by Dr. Ranjana and Dr. Achla, madam. So therefore, all these behavioral therapies should be tried. And if this does not work, of course, then we need to go to the pharmacological management. So in the pharmacological management, these are the different drugs. Anticholinergics or that is the main line of the therapy. The previous slide, madam. So oxybutynin is generally no longer used because of the side effects, but there are other drugs which are still used. Tolterodine is a drug which is a long acting therapy and can be used in a dose of 4 milligrams just once a day. What is more commonly used nowadays is the darifenacin and solifenacin. Darifenacin is given starting in a dose of 7.5 milligram once a day, and then you can increase it to 15 milligrams. Solifenacin can be given in a dose of 5 milligrams once a day, then you can increase it to 10 milligrams. And then there is the new drug on the block, that is mirabegron, which is a beta agonist, which is also very effective. And sometimes we need to give combinations. Also sometimes like you may require to give us a solifenacin along with a mirabegron if one drug is not effective. The side effects, these drugs do have some side effects. So therefore we need to be aware of that. Common side effects include constipation, impaired cognition, that is sometimes seen, sedation or blurred vision. What is very important is that we should rule out possibility of glaucoma in these patients because they can increase the intraocular pressure. So therefore, these drugs should not be used in patients with a narrow angle glaucoma. As I said, cognitive functions can be a problem. So therefore, in frail patients, particularly we need to, previous slide, man. In frail patients, we need to be, we need to be extra cautious. then there are, therefore, because of that, sometimes slow release preparations are preferred. Next slide.
No. You just tell me.
Yeah. Okay. The other drug that is nowadays is also the new drug that is mirabegron. It is basically a beta agonist, and it is been found that there is almost a 1.5 times reduction in the frequency of her passing urine. So therefore, it is definitely quite effective. This can be started in a dose of 50 milligrams a day, and then increased if necessary to 100 milligrams. And as I said, sometimes it is used in combination along with the anticholinergic. So you can give it like I'll combine it with the solifenacin or a darephenacin. And here you have to be cautious about two things. One is the patient should not be having any renal problems. So therefore, need to do a creatinine level or some basic renal test need to be done. And secondly, hypertension. It may give rise to hypertension. So therefore, a patient who is already hypertensive, generally we don't prefer to give mirabegron. So that is other drug. Now, beyond that, there are some other therapies also, which are the non-medical, I mean, apart from drugs. In that, there is a botulinum toxin is used, what we all know as Botox. Basically, it is something which sort of paralyzes the bladder. So just like how it also it is used for your wrinkles and things like that, it is also in the same way injected into the bladder. So it can be given also. Now, in case of botulinum toxin, we have to just remember that the patient should be asked to follow up regularly, because follow-up is important, because they should sometimes, this because of the bladder being paralyzed kind of, they might have retention. So therefore, we have to call them to check the post-void urine to see how much is the urine left in the bladder and how much is the residual urine. And that apart, there are other therapies also, that is peripheral tibial nerve stimulation. That is another form of treatment. Sometimes sacral neuromodulation is also another form of treatment. And that apart, finally, some additional treatments like augmentation cystoplasty and even indwelling catheters. Sometimes we may even need to go for those kinds of treatments. But of course, these are the last resorts. The most, very often, only by drug therapy, they can be managed. But as I said, very often, combination is required. You have to give behavioral therapy along with drug therapy, and sometimes, if necessary, some of these additional treatments like using intradetrusor Botox also might be recommended.
Thank you, Dr. Nagarkatti, for giving a very crisp message. So the thing is that we have many things in our kitty when the patient comes for the urinary incontinence. From ranging from the first line therapy, that is the physical therapies of various type, to the medical management, to the surgical management. But there was a gap of between something medical and surgical. There is a gap which is called a non-surgical modalities. So there are many new non-surgical modalities.
Ma'am, can we take few questions here?
No, I will just finish off and then we'll go to the question. I will not take much time. So this other, just filling the treatment gap, is still not most of the regulatory bodies still not given a go ahead, but it is in the market for last 10 years and giving a varying effect, and many people are very happy with this. So, patient mild SUI, have everything, not a candidate for even a surgery, what to do? So, there are certain new non-surgical modalities like injectable bulking agent, as Dr. Ashla has said, Raman has said, but it is little messy, very costly, and for the short period. There's a radio frequency collagen denaturation, and there's a new modalities which we are doing,
is a carbon dioxide fractional laser for this patient along with the HIFEM and adjuvant PRP is given. And in literature, coming future is the stem cells. So injectable bulking agent is still safety is appears to be good, but serious complication rarely occur, but it is very costly and the short term. The next thing is a HIFEM technology, that is the mechanism of action is high intensity focus electromagnetic fields, which are generally by a coil positioned inside a chair applicator. And what it causes is depolarize the pelvic floor motor neurons and it strengthen the pelvic muscles. With a laser, we are not going to strengthen the muscle.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you. Right. We couldn't hear for the last 5 minutes what you were talking. Can you please restart it? Ma'am,
hello?
The Zoom had gone.
Hello?
Hello, ma'am. Zoom had gone and we couldn't hear anything what you were talking.
Okay, so...
Can you please restart from the first slide?
So, you can talk. Chandan, you can talk.
नहीं मैम हमने आपका सुना ही नहीं है मतलब बीच में मज़ूम चला गया था
अभी आ रहा है
ना क्या होगा चंद्र
अब आ रहा है अब आ रहा है
सुना ही नहीं रहा
वी हैड आई हैड एवरीथिंग
ओके
सम पीपल आर नॉट एबल टू
ओके सो देयर आर ओके कमिंग टू टू थिंग्स वन थिंग इज दिस स्फीयर व्हिच हैज अ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक वेव्स इट गोस इनसाइड द पेल्विक मसल्स एंड द पेल्विक डायफ्राम एंड स्ट्रेंथ इट एंड सेकंड थिंग वी हैव अ लेजर व्हिच लेजर एनर्जी कॉजेस द collagen remodeling by denaturation, neogenesis, and collagen from type 5 to become the type 1, which is the collagen which gives a strength. And this transvaginal use of the thermoablative fractional carbon dioxide laser can activate this collagen and lead to the strengthening of that hammock which support to the urethra. It is an attractive alternative method and best option for the patient with GSM and mild SUI who either do not have a surgical indication or have a contraindication to the surgery. Their PRP is also tried to give as a urethral sphincter injection or in the para-urethral space along with this laser or patient do respond to this thing. And in future, there is a stem cell is also in the trial. In the experimental states, and they can be replaced the as a bulking agent also in the future. So in the end, before I take your question, these are the simple questionnaire for all the women. If you have this thing that you leak the urine and severity of leakage, mild, moderate or severe, or you often leak urine as by Dr. Ranna that or Dr. Ashla also sitting or lying, do you leak continuously or it causes an effect on your lifestyle? If answer is yes of any of these questions, that means this incontinence may be preventing you from enjoying your life. Quality of life is very, very important. Speak to your doctor to find the most effective treatment option for you. Chandra, over to you for the question answers and to the, all the panelists. Give after this question answer one line take home message. Over to you if there's any question.
Yes, ma'am, there are many questions. And first of all, they are all congratulating you for an excellent webinar. And there was a question that they want a Hindi language pictorial. This is from Professor Dr. Sanu Maya. They want a pictorial form of Hindi language, pictorial form of the pictures that void diary and is it possible?
Yeah, we'll tell the Eurogyne committee of Foxy to make it or Dr. Nagarkatti can take it. We'll see.
And somebody wants to know, is the asymptomatic bacteria should be treated or not? Dr. Vidya, I think, should answer that.
Yes, asymptomatic bacteria during pregnancy must and should be treated. But if you see asymptomatic bacteria in non-pregnant women, there is no evidence as such to treat this asymptomatic bacteria. Okay. There are so many Cochrane reviews I have seen that they have said that asymptomatic bacteria in any adult woman who doesn't have any symptoms does not require any treatment, because the patient will not come to you, and routinely if you have checked and it shows a symptomatic bacteria, it need not be treated. But yes, in pregnant woman, it should be treated. Yes.
Ma'am, what is the importance of the colony count?
It is very important. Infectious disease, whatever the society is there, we take 10:5. But the recent guidelines, they say that it should be 10:3 itself. So it is important to know about the colony count. If it is 10:5, you usually send these patients urine for culture and sensitivity.
Thank you very much. Is there any empirical treatment for the fungal infection of urinary tract?
Fungal infection yes. In the urine, yeah. Fluconazole can be given in these patients. Fluconazole, candidurea. Okay.
Any comment from Raman?
Dr. Raman?
Ma'am, I think you are the best judges for this, for fungal yeah. infection.
If you are suspecting vaginal infections, I suppose.
So, usually,
fungal infection. If fungus is seen in a urine, complete
diabetes,
urine, usually it is from the vagina, not from the urine.
Vagina, yes.
So you have to see the vaginitis and exclude the vaginitis.
What I would suggest would be to send a repeat sample after explaining to women how she has to give the sample, completely cleaning, then giving a midstream, because it's not really possible to have a fungal infection of the urine and patient being systemically not.
But Achala, it has been reported. Candidurea is also reported.
The patient is clinically also sick, because it's systemic infection,
not a solitary urine infection like
the guidelines. The guidelines would say that you treat fungal infection only if the patient has strong symptoms and no other causes
other causes are ruled out.
Dr. Raman, one word about the residual urine when we do a KUB. How significant it is?
So, ma'am, normally, the residual urine should be less than 20%. That is what we as urologists would say. For a female, it should be even less. That's what I personally feel. And usually if the residual urine is more than that, we have to kind of look into it with suspicion. The first test that I would want to do in such a situation is a uroflowmetry to understand whether this is because of a bladder weakness being there, or is it that the outlet is too closed that, the bladder is not able to empty itself. So the uroflowmetry would give us a very good idea on this. And then we take it forward. If we feel that the bladder outlet is blocked, then we either give an alpha blocker to the patient, which opens the passage, or we dilate the patient, we do a urethral calibration. And if we feel that it is because of a bladder weakness, then we take the patient straight away for a urodynamic study to understand how weak the muscles of the bladder are.
Do you suggest that we should specifically ask for residual urine in such patients?
Ma'am, for all patients, whenever we are ordering any urogynecology patient, I think if there's one more important test than anything else, that's the post-void residual urine. This gives us a lot of information.
This was very much stressed by Dr. Ranjana. There's two things very important. One is a post-void urine, and second thing is a proper study of the voiding diary.
There are three things: urine examination, bladder diary, and post-void. These things are a must.
Dr. Ranjana, is there any role of vitamin D and calcium in preventing SUI?
Ranjana, ma'am.
Ranjana,
you can answer.
Anybody can answer that.
Vitamin D has been implicated in everything.
Everything.
There is no evidence specifically in urinary problem, and then you say as a part of muscle tone improvement.
There are no guidelines.
Okay,
vitamin
Dr. Achala.
They are good for your health, but there is no evidence that it has any value in incontinence.
Okay, Dr. Achala. To deal with sarcocolpopexy induced urinary incontinence.
Pardon, I didn't get you.
how to deal with this. Somebody has had a sarcocolpopexy operation and now she develops a urinary incontinence as well. How to deal with it?
The management, she's already had an abdominal operation. So you can first evaluate what is the cause, and if it is SUI only, depending on her age, you know, patient, you can't have a patient just like that, that diagnosis. You have to have a patient in total. What is the problem? How much is the problem? What is the age? All the choices which are there for SUI, they are there. She can have a vaginal tape. She can have a fibrous thing. But she would definitely won't like to have another abdominal surgery now. So the vaginal tape would be a good option.
Live interaction.
Dr. Ajna, can I further?
Sure, sure. Yes, please.
Ma'am, so basically, if we've had a incontinence surgery earlier, for example, if the patient has had something as big as a...
No, she didn't have an incontinence surgery. No,
she had a prolapse surgery. So basically, there again, we have to understand that most common reason there are two reasons which can lead to the incontinence. One is there is some sort of an urgency there, which is still remaining. And of course, the entire management of SUI should go. But another important fact that I wanted to see, because I've seen certain patients on this, that sometimes there could be a damage to the nearby nerves and that leads to a neurogenic bladder-like condition. Yes, yes. So this in particular should be noted in these patients, extra from what you know, we normally would.
You can't have one situation like that. The patient has to be evaluated in total to see what is exactly.
What is the cause?
Absolutely. Yeah. Agree to that.
Yes, Dr. Ragini.
Can I answer this question?
Hello, yes. Anybody.
So what specifically they have mentioned sacrocolpopexy, where you are nowhere near bladder, you know, so that this particular operation will not lead to incontinence or urge incontinence. Okay. So I think she had this before and then it was not addressed. And sometimes there is already, you know, any operation has caused constriction and this must have caused detrusor overactivity, which can also cause incontinence. Yeah.
Neurogenic.
Ma'am, also I've seen that sometimes, you know, when you do these prolapse, it's already compressing the urethra. So some sort of a ISD is masked because of it. Suddenly when you kind of do the surgery, it becomes unmasked. So it's also something we should, but I think that's the topic in itself for a lot of debate. So we can move on to the next.
There's one very interesting question. Is there treatment of the bedwetting in adults? Dr. Mala, can you take this question? Treatment of bedwetting in adults. Then we will go live.
Adults, yes.
See, basically, when we get bedwetting started, see whether this problem has been there since the childhood or it is a recent development. If it is a recent development, maybe the patient had some neurological problem recently. But if it is present since childhood, then in some, I think we have to take our urologist into confidence and this problem cannot be treated easily because this patient will require bladder training. They will require a lot of counseling. But not to take fluids after 7 p.m., restrict their fluid intake, and a lot of counseling has to be done to these patients so that they can improve this bedwetting problem. And of course, there is a role of some drugs which can be taken with the counseling, together with the urologist or nephrologist we have to take. We have to also rule out infections in these girls. And we have to also rule out some congenital malformations also in these girls. Sometimes there is a double urethra or some other congenital malformations that can also give rise to bedwetting in the adults. And then when we have problems in diagnosing these patients, then we can take the help of our urologist friends who can diagnose and help us in treating these patients. These are difficult patients to be treated.
So Raman can come in.
Dr. Raman, how much is the charge of the urodynamic investigations?
So, urodynamic investigation, the charge is roughly starting from about 5,000 rupees because it involves a lot of consumables and a lot of time from a urologist. But again, you know, depending on what kind of machine there is, because a urodynamic machine starts from about 7 to 8 lakh rupees and goes up to 1 crore. So then again, it depends on a lot of factors like these. And usually it's, of course, on the higher side, but that's why it's a very reserved test only for those who really need it. You have to earn a urodynamic test,
basically. Dr. Ragni, somebody's mother is 95 and she has stress incontinence. So best treatment for her?
So we are going to live with a few patients.
Deepika?
Yes, Deepika. Ma'am, we would like to go for some questions from the audience. So we have Dr. Neeta Bajaj who can ask a few questions. Probably her hand was up.
Mute her.
Yeah, I've unmuted. Dr. Neeta Bajaj, you can please ask your question. Dr. Neeta?
Sorry.
Go to next. Yeah, okay.
Sorry, by mistake, my hand came there. I don't want to ask any question.
Next raise hand.
Dr. Pushpa Garg, if you would like to ask a question. You have to unmute yourself, Dr. Pushpa Garg. We have Shweta Rajput and Kalai Amal. Anybody wants to ask a question, you can unmute yourself and ask. Then we have many hands raised actually. Abhash Sood, you can ask your question. KK Nawal. Then we have Rekha Tandon. Anybody wants to ask a question, you have to unmute yourself.
If there is nobody, then we can take one or two questions more, then we will wind up.
We have Sangeeta Pava, probably she wants to ask. Anybody wants to ask a question from the audience, you can raise your hand and ask your question. Dr. KK Nawal.
Ma'am, the audience wants to share, to have the share of voiding diary and the uroflowmetry charts. How can we do that?
We will send this part of the voiding diary and
yes.
Deepika, you have registered numbers. Yeah, I will share with you and you'll send to them.
We'll be having email addresses of everybody.
Yeah, yeah. So please send them. We are registered, all the registered candidates.
Okay. We have Dr. Yeah. Vinita Yadav. She would want to ask a question.
I want to ask for how long can they give diraphenacin or solifenacin?
Pardon, come again?
For
then how long you can give diraphenacin?
Yeah, Dr. Nagarkatti.
Yeah, I think it can be given for easily for 6 months to a year. And then after that, the patient can be reassessed, I think.
Sir, somebody is asking for fluoxetine also.
Fluoxetine.
I can't pronounce it.
Very old medicine.
Yeah. How long can you give?
So, ma'am, fluoxetine in today's world, I think everybody would deny doesn't have much of a role.
Much.
She should better shift to a newer drug.
Newer drug.
Because there are so many, yes.
Yeah. I think it was the drug which first came in the market, say in 90, I don't even remember, it is 2000 or so when we started understanding urogyne and what is uroincontinence.
Actually, the question is that how long can a pharmacological treatment be given? When should we switch to some other treatment?
Six months to one year, I think is a fair enough year. I mean,
not required for that time.
Raman can come in, right?
Raman.
So, ma'am,
how long the pharmacological treatment can be?
So, ma'am, of course, the thing is that, you know, we are burdened with a lot of drugs right now. And it all depends. The answer depends on how well the patient has been doing on the medication. So, has the patient also been given adequate time to tone their muscles up? And what exactly is the level of relief that the patient has? There are studies available which say that for many years, you can safely continue the anticholinergic medications. Mirabegron, the trial for Mirabegron in India happened in the center where I was doing my training, luckily. So for Mirabegron, we don't have a very large data as of now, but definitely for other anticholinergics, the older ones like diraphenacin And for solifenacin, we have data to support that many years of medication can be given, provided that the patient has some benefit over it. The other thing that we have seen is often the efficacy of the medicine is lost. So it is important to timely and periodically and to timely change the medicine. Sometimes we have to use a combination, sometimes we have to change or switch to a newer medication. But then, of course, we ultimately want the best for the patient and we want good quality of life of the patient. So if the patient can be on medicines and is getting good relief, it can be given for many years together.
Okay. Yes, even I have very good personal experience of patients, you know, they keep on taking it for years, you know, without any side effects also. So they're very happy. They don't want anything else.
But at the same time, we have to make them understand. The patient should not be given the message that this is a solution for them. We have to make them understand that this is only to help them to get some time to start exercising.
Correct.
Build up themselves. Because this is not the way to live.
Correct.
Dr. Sudha Sharma is asking that a girl 12 years old complains of frequency but does not have UTI on urine analysis. What else can we think of? Dr. Ranjana, can you please answer that question?
Yeah, so a 12-year-old girl comes with any frequency. Urinary problem. Make sure that she hasn't been abused.
Yeah.
So you always keep that in mind.
Yes.
And local examination should be done for hygiene. And then if it is a newly developed thing, it's a different thing, but I'll check for reflux also. Right?
So another question was, about the bed wetting in young children, I mean, young adults, maybe 14, 15-year-old. So is there
I think Raman should take this.
Dr. Raman should take this, yes. Dr. Raman, because this must have come from non-medical,
understand. Yeah. So basically, whenever we deal with nocturnal NURSS or bedwetting, we have to basically consider of two types. One is primary. So primary is the one where the patient has never been dry. So that's a totally different situation. And the other is a secondary nocturnal enuresis, which usually arises from various conditions, which could start from a simple UTI to something as complex as a neurogenic bladder. So I think the question of the patient has an entire lecture dedicated to itself. That's what it deserves. But basically, we can say that it was earlier pointed out, if it's a primary one that it's been there since birth, then we think about congenital problems mainly. And we think about the bladder being small. We think about the neurological and the neuroplastic situations that the training has not been proper. If it's a secondary one, we think about UTI. We think about recent neurological traumas, deficits, spinal cord tumors. We think about some sort of other localized infection. We can also think certain complicated situations like genital urinary tuberculosis. We can think about some other specific diseases, especially the neurological diseases like ALS, MS, all those kind of things. So a very big range of differential diagnosis lies behind us.
I think we can have another lecture. We can have a session on this.
I think it deserves that.
This is a very important task. Yes. It deserves that. With the common public.
Answer one question. What do you give a diabetic hypertensive patient? Which drug you will prefer to give?
So, ma'am, basically, ideally, my drug of choice these days is mirabegron. The reason being that it is quite safe and well tolerated by most patients. It's a beta-3 agonist. The problem is that it can increase BP in some patients. There are studies to say that. So in such a condition where we have a hypertensive diabetic patient, I would like to keep berifenacin as the drug of choice for my patient. That's what I would personally prefer.
Dr. Raman, I just wanted to ask you if we give it for a long time after 1 or 2 years of giving either any of these drugs or even in combination. Sometimes we need to give combination of along with so then what's the next choice of management be in terms of, would it be Botox or would it be something else like the neuromodulation or something like that?
Sir, although there is no guideline to this as per endorsed by the USA as yet, but I personally feel that these patients who have not been doing well with medicine should go for more invasive testing first. So okay. Uroflowmetry or urodynamics should be the ideal thing we should do. And if we find that there is a debilitating overactivity of the detrusor, then of course we can go for something less invasive like Botox. And it's quite it's a very good treatment. I do it all the time.
Okay.
And usually 9 to 1 year is what the patient really gets a benefit for. So you have to counsel the patient, and Botox is a very good option in these cases before we go for the other lines of management.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Deepika, do we have a recording of this?
Yes,
there on the Facebook. There will be a recording, and we'll be sharing the link with everybody. Right now, it is on Facebook Live. That number I will just put down here. The Facebook link, I'll put it here.
Yes.
Yeah, and I see Dr. Ampuja, she wants to ask a question. So her hand was raised. If you
void in charge.
Dr. Ambuja, ma'am, please unmute yourself and ask.
So is this on the...
Yeah, what I want to say is about the nocturnal aneurysms in children, especially in the adolescent age group. I think we should think of pinworms and intestinal worms. That's also many times they come with us.
Yes, yes.
Because always we should not think only urinary problem. Pinworms also is a problem, especially night times. And to examine, you will see pinworms also. Are you able to hear me, Ragini?
We also
yes,
see
yes,
the...
Yes.
Yeah,
psychology.
Yeah, we are able
yes,
to hear
yes,
you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And thank the psychological...
Good
mental
evening,
setup of the...
Good to have you on the show, madam.
Yes.
Welcome, ma'am. Welcome, Ambuja, ma'am.
We have Dr. Siddesh also wanting to ask.
Yeah, that's what I told you. Nocturnal aneurysms sometimes... Maybe because of the pinworms.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And other worms also will be there. And especially when you examine night times, you can see the pinworms also. So that time it is the, stool analysis is very, very important. With one dose of prednisone, usually it gets cured. Always should never think that it is only urinary problem. Some of the things, it is the intestinal factor also will be there.
Aneurysis, we can take a panel on aneurysis. It's such an important subject.
Yeah, yes. It's a very good panel. Yeah.
Yes,
congratulations to everybody. It is a very good panel. Ragini especially.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes,
this is Dr. Siddesh here. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, actually, after listening to the entire talk, I just wanted a little clarification in which cases we should do uroflowmetry and which cases we should do urodynamics. That's all. Thank you.
Very simple language. Raman, answer it. 1, 2, 3, 4.
So, when a patient comes to us and we feel that there's an incontinence, first we do the basic thing like every doctor does. We ask the patient about symptoms, we examine the patient, and we start a treatment. So if the patient does well on the treatment, there is no indication to go for these kind of tests. If we feel that the response to the medication is not poor, is not good, and we feel that it could be a more complicated problem. For example, the patient says there's constipation, the patient says there's a backache, or there are certain things which are complicating the history. In those cases, it is strongly advised. And also before we go for an invasive surgery, it is strongly advised that we do these kind of tests. I think that's the simplest way I can answer this.
So can I just come here? You see, about the urodynamics. So we have got Royal College nice guidelines. So now they say if somebody has pure stress urinary, I'm just telling you the guidelines, right? So if there is pure stress urinary incontinence and she has no other symptoms, no other medical comorbidity like neurological, and you are not confused with anything, then you can go ahead and do a case surgery or whatever, right? So surgical treatment is allowed. But somebody who's had a failure of surgery, or who has mixed incontinence, or who has associated prolapse, or who has a neurological disorder, then we have to do urodynamics before continent surgery.
I think Raman very nicely given the Indian Urological Association guidelines, which said the same thing.
Okay. One more thing, Raman, I just want to clarify. You said, you know, I said technicians can do urodynamics. So I used to run a urodynamic clinic for all the gynecologists in England. So, doctor's input is very, very important. What I have seen here, and even there, you know, doctor will interpret the result, but the technician will help with all the setting up the machine and sitting at the computer. So we too used to be in the clinic together. The technician would sit with the computer and all these machines and everything, and I would go and ask the patient and provocation I would do, as you said, you know, because I would write the report and I would give the gynecologist my opinion what is the right operation for her and what I have seen in the urodynamics.
Bad news for Raman and a good news for patients that I have acquired a machine in government hospital, Safdarjung in Gandhi department, urodynamics. So I can be sent patients.
Wonderful, because stress incontinence and all is very common in the lower socioeconomic strata. They have more child, more vaginal birth, and they suffer more silently than the upper strata women. Congratulations, Dr. Ashla. It's a wonderful news, and it has gone to many people, and many, many women will benefit it.
As a workup of prolapse, sometimes when the patient has urinary problem as well with the prolapse, we all, as a routine, we get a urodynamic study before the surgery or the prolapse is done.
No, I don't think for a
But if patient is having a lot of urinary problems, then sometimes we have
In a case of prolapse, you should also look for occult stress urinary incontinence. So reduce and see whether she is, there is kinking. When there is a prolapse, there is kinking of the urethra. And if you ask the patient to cough, stress test is negative. There will be no leakage on coughing. But if you reduce the prolapse with a sponge holding or something, and then ask the patient to cough, and there is a leakage. So you know, if you do a corrective surgery for prolapse, she will swap her problem with a stress urinary, and she will blame you for SUI. So, you know, this patient needs counseling.
But even the patient is having a clear-cut SUI with the prolapse. Is it advisable to operate? I don't think so. Is it advisable in the same sitting to SUI?
Yes, you can do in the same sitting.
If you have SUI clear cut, there you must have a urodynamic before you operate. Because this comes under
one thing, I told you, this is an associated prolapse, you have to do urodynamics and you have to do a corrective surgery for both.
Yeah.
But try to have an incision for the tape, separate from the incision for cystocele repair.
Counsel the patient.
Why not to give Kelly sutures?
Kelly's is outdated. But many a time, the big cystocele patient become okay.
Ragini, we treat the patients, they become okay, but maybe we should do studies. But whatever studies are there, they say long term, only 35% success. 60% they'll have revoked.
We should bind up now.
Yeah. Ma'am, we can have one more question from Dr. Sunila Khandelwal. She's raised her hand.
Dr. Sunila Khandelwal, madam is here. Wow.
Welcome, ma'am.
Ma'am, you have to unmute yourself to ask the question, ma'am. Dr. Sunila Khandelwal.
Yeah, first of all, congratulations, Ragini, everybody. It was wonderful. And it was more than wonderful to see all of you. So I just couldn't resist. I just got time and I was here and I enjoyed the whole session. My question is that are you able to hear Ragini?
Yes, ma'am.
We want to see you.
Ma'am, start your video, please.
Ma'am, I'll just make her a panelist.
Yes.
So now you can start your video, ma'am.
Yeah.
Dr. Sunila, now you can start your video. She's not able to, I think.
Okay.
I just promoted her to a panelist post.
Okay, she can speak only then.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Please do speak, ma'am.
I think she has to re-enter.
Just a minute.
You can start your video. It will work now because we have made you into the panelist.
Deepika, we agree anyway, that you are the boss.
Hi.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi. No, I just wanted to just congratulate each one of you. It was wonderful. But I really want to just know that the recent updates related to the use of lasers in GUSM is there. But there was, I read in NAMS also, the Menopause Day General of Menopause, that there is a lot of controversies have arrived for the use. It's related to like dyspareunia, fibrosis. So the we call it as technovagina, you know. So I'm just thinking whether still there is a place or the YAG laser has taken a place of carbon dioxide laser in comparison to, you know, the outcomes. So anyone can answer those.
As far as I can say my personal experience and the other colleagues who are doing, even my cousin, she is in Washington, D.C. She has Mona Lisa laser and practicing in Washington, D.C. with that laser. She's a urogynecologist for 8 years. And our experience with the menopausal woman is much, much better than younger women as far as laser is concerned. The biggest problem with the laser is that people buy the left and right, all those laser who are not up to the mark. That is the main problem. And secondly, when you apply laser in a older woman, you have to start with a very, very low energy. So if you're not properly trained and you apply a bigger energy, naturally that woman is going to have a burn. Because what laser does? Laser is absorbed by the chromophore, and here chromophore is a water. And in elderly women, postmenopausal women, there you also know that moisture is very less. So starting with those women, very low energy and not very too many passes, go very slow. And even in the second sitting when they come, they themselves say they are feeling so better, that tightness has gone, all the time that feeling has gone. So in the GSM, what I found is much, much better than my results in the comparatively the younger woman. There I need a lots of other things to evaluate before offering the laser.
Yeah. Because I think, I don't know how many, means do we have any Indian studies for the follow-up of these patients of lasers?
We are doing it under
agglutination and penetration injuries and all, because young women, they are high profile women, they do come for the lasers. So I just wanted to know what is the status and what is the experience which you all have gained using these lasers. And moreover, there was one thing also in my mind. In India, we don't have restaurant which is available for dyspareunia. So do we have anything, an alternative to that?
You can better answer for that. You are an expert menopause specialist.
No, nothing is available. Sunila. Yeah. No, it's because
no alternative.
To my knowledge, it is not available. So I was just wondering, like they have steroid intravaginal progesterone, but we don't have. So if at all women have this fibrosis and all those things, so I think we don't have anything to offer them. So anyhow, I loved this session and I enjoyed, and congratulations to all of you, and nice to see you, Ranjana.
Hi, nice to see you, Sunila, after a long time.
Now it is cross 7.
Thank you for joining in.
Okay. Bye, everyone. Bye, Dr. Nagarkoti.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr. Deepika.
Thank you a lot.
And a big thanks to Deepika.
Yeah. As usual, managed well.
Okay, madam. Dr. Achala, madam, thank you.
Okay, bye-bye, Dr. Ajit.